Thank you very much, Kiki, for a very kind introduction, a very good morning to all of you. It is a great pleasure to be here to, and it's an honor, of course, to deliver the 11th Sadli Lecture 2017. And the title of my presentation today is The Tale of Two Countries, India and Indonesia, a lesson learned from 2013 April Tantrum. Before I begin my presentation, let me say a few words about the late Professor Sadli. I knew Pak Sadli when I was a small, a little kid actually, because I heard a lot about him from my father. Pak Sadli was Minister of Manpower 1971 to 1973, and at that time my father was his Secretary General. So I heard a lot about him from my dad, and you know, he kept telling me how brilliant Pak Sadli was, how genuine and original about this. And later on I found out it was true that Pak Sadli was really a genuine, was really a brilliant. So before I start my presentation, let me say, share with you some experience about Pak Sadli. First of all, one thing that came up to my mind every time I heard about Pak Sadli, I would say Pak Sadli is a constant optimist. So for those who are pessimistic about the Indonesian economy, you better learn from Pak Sadli. Yeah? There are at least three experiences with Pak Sadli. The first one I recall during the 98 to 2000, perhaps Ibu Maria at that time, we were so pessimistic about the muddle through of the Indonesian economy, because the economy grew by only about 2 to 3%, 2 to 4%. But every time I spoke with Pak Sadli, he said that don't worry about it. There is no country in the world who did radical political reform and economic reform at the same time in one night. And even our close competitor was Philippines. Even Indonesia did a radical reform compared to Philippines. So if Indonesia can still grow by 3 to 4%, it's already good. You don't need to worry about it. So he always asked to learn about, to look at Indonesia from the comparative perspective. The second one, Pak Sadli always believed, and this is very important for the policy maker. That's what we call the Sadli's law. Bad times makes good policy, and good times makes bad policy. So when the economy is in the bad times, he always said, don't worry about it, because you can always use this momentum to do reform. So he always look at everything from the, from the very positive perspective. The last part is his view on protectionism. I was so worried about the trend of trade protectionism at that time, so I wrote an email to Pak Sadli. And let me read his email dated September 27, 1998 to me. So how long it was?
19 years.
19 years ago. And he said that like this. I read it to you in bahasa Indonesia. Sebagai catatan pinggir, bisa dikemukakan bahwa negara kepulauan seperti Indonesia yang berbatasan dengan Singapura yang merupakan freeport, contoh lain Filipina yang dekat Hong Kong, ada natural limit untuk protection, karena biaya penyelundupan adalah sekitar 15% dari ongkos pengadaan. So, what's Pak Sadli point is, you don't need to worry about this protectionism, because you impose the trade, the import tariff is higher than 50%, the smuggling will come anyway. So, there is a natural limit of this protectionism. So, again, he said that, you can see all the things in a very, from the positive perspective. And the last part before I conclude, I remember my trip to Tokyo with him back on 2004. We went to Akihabara because he likes gadget very much. And then one thing that surprised me, he spoke to the shopkeeper in Bahasa Indonesia. So I asked Pak Sadli, why you speak to them in Bahasa Indonesia? And his response was really genuine and very surprising. He said that he doesn't understand English either. Why should I speak in Bahasa Inggris? It's a very pragmatic. So having said that, let me Let me begin the Sadli lecture of the 2017. Okay, let me start with the, I called Indonesia, India is Indonesia without resources. Because we have a very, we have many similarities between Indonesia and India. Yeah, the first one is both country among the member of the G20 has a relative strong economic growth. And those two countries were classified as a fragile five during the taper tantrum 2013. And then if you're talking about India, the last time I was in India was almost about a year ago. And really remind me with the situation in Indonesia with the poor quality of infrastructure. If people talk, if people concern about this infrastructure, you better go to Delhi or to Mumbai, and you will see that we are not too bad. Yeah? If you're concerned and worry about this vibrant democracy, go to India. Then you'll see everyone will criticize government, will talk in the newspaper, on TV to criticize it. It reminds me exactly the same in Indonesia. If you complain about bureaucratic hurdles, please go to India, because you will find a very good example about, you know, bureaucratic hurdles there. Yeah. If you're talking about large population, both countries are very similar. Poverty issue, poverty in India is also a big issue. And then low quality of this human capital. Even though I have to say, even though India has a very good, you know, a very talented people, but if you're talking about the critical mass, both countries not ready for this good quality of this human capital. So looking from this similar, from this perspective, it is very important to look at the lesson learned of 2013 and why India performed better after that. Yeah, because we started from the same ground. So the questions to be addressed is, how did India and Indonesia manage to escape the fragile five, the taper tantrum? The second one, what policies were undertaken and why were they chosen? Why India performed better after the taper tantrum? Explaining this and deliver this lecture in front of these two prominent discussants is rather difficult for me, because the first discussant, Professor Mari Pangestu, literally was my teacher. I took her class. Three classes at least. So it's really like an exam to me. International trade, one, two, and also the monetary, and also the economic seminar. Every time I see her, it reminds me nightmare days during the undergraduate study. And Reza Siregar was my classmate at the junior high school. So it is rather difficult to give a presentation here. Yeah. Because two closely related. So let me start with the comparing Indonesia and India. Yeah. India, the interesting part of India is the economy, the growth was basically driven by FDI, especially on the services export. If you're talking about IT, services like, how do you say that? Operator, yeah. We, every time we try to called probably like airlines office or bank office, we often hear the Indian accent, yeah, anywhere in the world, yeah. And strong domestic demand as well, because the private consumption is contributed a significant percentage of GDP. But India had an experience slowest economic growth 2010-2012 due to the macroeconomic imbalances. So they got a problem before us, yeah. This is related to the issue of this high inflation, the budget deficit, the current account deficit, capital inflow. And similar to Indonesia, India, as mentioned by Minister Simulyani, India had the benefit of the quantitative easing one. Yeah. For the case of Indonesia, unlike India, our export is about 60% energy and commodity related. So thanks to the commodity super cycle and thanks to the quantitative easing, our economy reached about more than 6% during the period of 2004 to 2012. Yeah. Overall, it's about 5.8 during the last 10 years, 2004-2014. FDI, unlike on the India on the services export, our foreign direct investment was mostly on domestic market and natural resources. It is understandable because the commodity boom. And pre-taper tantrum, Indonesia was of the one of the darling of the foreign investor, because no one can could afford to miss Indonesia and India at that time. But look at what happened. The chairman Bernanke made a statement, a very short statement, but long impact to emerging market. It was dated May 23rd, 2013. At the time, I was in the parliament proposing for the fuel price adjustment. The statement was a very simple one. The committee currently anticipates that it will be appropriate to moderate the monthly pace of purchase later this year. Look at the impact of this statement. The market collapsed. Yeah, the market collapsed. You see the exchange rate collapse just few days, few weeks after that. The bond yield, the 10 years, the 10-year bond yield increased quite substantially, from less than 7% at that time to become even reach 9.5%. And if you look at the stock market collapsed. Yeah. So we at the emerging market, we complained about it, because at the time our economy was pretty much was in a good shape. But all of a sudden, because statement made by the chairman Bernanke, there was a shock in our economy. Interestingly, I got a chance to talk to speak with the is now a professor at Dartmouth. He was the one who prepared the a press statement for Chairman Bernanke at the time. Yeah, so I met him at Brookings last year, and he told me at the time actually Chairman Bernanke was not prepared at all to respond to the question to the Congress. So his statement was not a sort of like a well prepared statement. But it was perceived by the market that the U.S. will start to unwind the quantitative easing. And so at the emerging market, we try to respond by, you know, by asking, by Raghu Rajan, myself, Praveen, and also Mantega, yeah, during the G20, we asked for a better international policy coordination. But now, when I look at this statement, I myself become embarrassed, because as an economist, the question is, there is no such things as international policy coordination, because fiscal related to the sovereignty. There is no such things as monetary policy coordination at the global level. But you know, all of us ask for the international policy coordination. There is a need for that, but there is no channel, there is no instrument to do the external policy coordination. We'll talk about it later on, because this will be the important issues to be discussed in the future. Yeah. And then our complaint to Chairman Bernanke at the time during the G20 was to ask a better policy coordination. But his response was basically, of course this is not verbatim, but the message was, get your house in order. Yeah. Don't put the blame on the United States, because the Fed is responsible for their own domestic policy at a time. Yeah. And then, so we went back to Indonesia and tried to look at the what exactly what Minister Sri Mulyani said. What are the symptoms, the you know the cause, and try to look at what kind of policy that is possible to be implemented at the time. I still recall the response from colleague from the MOF and also the central bank at the time, and we got at the meeting. The response was, what happened to our economy? Because all of a sudden the rupiah collapsed, the stock market collapsed, the bond yield increased. The first response was, it's because the tapering talk by Chairman Bernanke. Then my next question at the time is, why it is true, but how do we explain why Singapore, Thailand, and Philippines were not affected by this? So there should be some other explanations beyond the tapering talk. So we try to look at, you know, some similarities. That's what Minister Sri Mulyani said, to look at about the data. I recall my conversation with her at that time, and she said that you have to distinguish Indonesia to other countries under the so-called the Fragile Five. So when I look at the GDP growth, our economy was relatively strong at that time, similar to in India at that time they grew by about 4.8%. If you look at Indonesia, 6.2%. So not too bad actually, both India and Indonesia. Definitely the explanation was not on the GDP growth. What about CPI? India, the inflation was about 7.5, Indonesia is about 8.6. Maybe that's one of the reasons. But before that, if you look at the 2012, inflation in Indonesia, 4.3% at that time was considered relatively good because our structural inflation is basically about 7 to 8%. So maybe the inflation is not also the main reason for it. When I look at the fiscal deficit to GDP, our deficit in India was about 8 to 7%, which is really bad. But in the case of Indonesia, it was only 1.8%. So definitely was not a fiscal issue. What about the government debt to GDP? Indonesia, the debt to GDP was only 23%. So the culprit must be a current account deficit. Yeah, because both what we call the Fatal Five, Brazil, Turkey, India, Indonesia, and South Africa, has a similarities that the current account deficit was relatively high. 6.1%, India 5.1%, Indonesia was 2.7%, that become to 2013, become 4.4%. So the main issue that we should address was addressing the current account deficit. Yeah, but I recall in my student days, Ibu Mari, when I took a class of public economics, some professor told me, you don't need to worry about current account deficit. Yeah, because as long as it is financed by the private sector, you just let the market to handle it. Basically, the current account deficit is not a problem. And there is an example of it. Australia is an example of a country who never worry about the current account deficit. So there is some evidence of it. But I think the situation is quite different in 2013 because this perspective probably is no longer correct. And one of the reasons is because of the capital account was financed by the portfolio. If you are financed by the foreign direct investment, but probably should be okay. Look at this India and Indonesia, the budget deficit. Let me make a comparison of it. For the case of Indonesia, I think the budget deficit is relatively small. But one thing I would like to emphasize this. Look at the case of Indonesia. The budget deficit was steadily rising, actually. The blue one was Indonesia. And one of the reasons was because of fuel subsidy. Yeah. In the case of India, they had a huge budget deficit. And one of the reasons for the huge budget deficit was also a subsidy for food in India. I recall during the G20 meeting, because India and Indonesia is sit next to each other. So we had a conversation with Raghu Rajan and Chinambara to exchange about the information. He asked me about the fuel subsidy and I asked him about the subsidy for food. Yeah. And then exactly that's what we did related to the fiscal policy to cut the fuel subsidy. This is a very busy chart, but let me try to speak in the human language to explain this busy chart. Yeah. The green line shows that the foreign reserve, as Minister Sri Mulyani said, that after the quantitative easing, our foreign reserve increased quite substantially, rapidly, basically. Within 2 years' time, the foreign reserve increased quite substantially, and if you look at the exchange rate, because the capital inflow, the exchange rate experienced an appreciation, and even reached probably at that time less than 9,000 rupiah per US dollar. Yeah, as the result of this capital inflow, the economic growth also improved. Look at the blue line, yeah. So that was the very good period of the Indonesian economy, thanks to the commodity boom, the commodity super cycle, and also to the capital inflow. But there is an implication of it, because the appreciation of the exchange rate, we lost our competitiveness in exchange rate in export. So if you look at the current account deficit, began to deteriorate because this overvaluation of the exchange rate. At the same time, also, it is also driven by the steadily increase of the budget deficit. due to the fuel subsidy. So the combination of this overvaluation of the exchange rate and the increase of the budget deficit deteriorate the current account deficit at the time. As a result, is again, this is very important for the students. If people said that the economic theory does not work in policy, the answer is wrong. It is work in the policy. I'll explain about it to you later on. Once the current account deficit experience, when the current account experienced a deficit, then there was a pressure on the depreciation of the exchange rate. But the way the Bank Indonesia responds at that time, instead of to rising the interest rate, or the government cut the fuel subsidy, what they did, they tried to prevent the exchange rate by intervening the forex market. So that's the reason why the forex market started to decline from 2011, because Bank Indonesia tried to maintain a stable exchange rate at that time, was around 9,700, 9,500, yeah, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, but there is a limit of it. Because our foreign reserve, look at the green line, steadily decreased until we decided to do what we call the expenditure switching and expenditure reducing policy. Interestingly, I learned those two terms from Ibu Mari's class. Because she said that if you have to deal, maybe at that time she doesn't realize that one day I have to implement this theory in managing the policy. I still recall using the textbook was Batis book, and also the Riviera Batis, and also Rogoff and Obstfeld. If you have to handle the current account deficit is basically a reflection of the excess demand. There are two possibilities. The ideal one, you improve on the supply side by improving infrastructure, investment climate, etc. But it takes time. Or if you have to, because the time is not on your side, you have to handle the demand side by doing this expenditure reducing policy. What is the expenditure reducing policy? You cut the fiscal deficit and should be combined by the expenditure switching policy, which is let the exchange rate to depreciate. Somehow this policy is related to the ANU, because the one who introduced this policy and related is a very famous, the so-called Swan diagram. Yeah, so it's again, this Indonesia project, it is important to mention this because Trevor Swan was a professor at the Australian National University. So we tried to implement this policy, yeah, because basically, let me talk a little bit about the theory. Because basically a current account deficit is a reflection of the saving investment gap and also the budget deficit gap. So if you want to improve the current account deficit, what you need to do, either you lower the investment or you cut the government spending. And that's exactly what we did. Yeah, I'll explain to you later on in the theory. Let me talk about India now. India experienced a very similar situation. The quantitative easing increased the foreign reserve, and then they experienced the overvaluation of the exchange rate. And then later on, they decided to do expenditure switching and expenditure reducing policy. And this is not only unique for the case of India, because this story happened to the Latin America. If you look at the Calvo, Lederman, and Reinhardt, you just replace the word of Latin America with Asia. Yeah, they said that they argued that falling interest rate, a continuing recession, and balance of payment development in the United States, along with developments in under-industrialized countries, has encouraged investors to shift their resources to Latin America. You just change the word emerging market. This is exactly what happened back on 1990. And then Reinhardt, Calvo, Lederman, and Reinhardt, they said there are three aspects that are very important. Common creditors, because usually this is the way the market works. That's why, you know, we cannot leave entirely to the market. The reason behind it is we are dealing with the bondholders, with the investment bankers, who have to deal with 100 countries. So there is no way they will understand country by country. So they use a benchmark. For example, like if the current account deficit cannot go beyond 3%, the inflation cannot go beyond 7%, the GDP growth cannot go lower than certain percent. So once it passed the threshold, they decided to pull out. Yeah. Probably Reza later on can also share because he had an experience to work with the investment bank, because they have to deal with 100 countries. So there is no way they could understand. So there is an issue about the common creditors, because once they said that, oh, Latin America is dangerous, they start to review their balance sheet in other countries as well. So the factor of common creditors is important. The second one is surprise crisis, like statement by the Chairman Bernanke. And incomplete information about specific country. I recall when I was Minister of Finance, I did a roadshow in the United States. There was one investor, they already invest in Indonesia, but their question is, Minister, let me ask you a question. Is Indonesia is a kingdom or a republic? But they already put they already invest a lot because the top down approach, because the growth number is good, because the inflation is good, without really knowing about the specific country. So we are dealing with the situation of this incomplete information. Under that kind of situation, there is a room for the government intervention, actually. Yeah. Now let me I'll skip this. Yeah. Let me move to the policy response. This is exactly what I mentioned to you earlier. What we did at the time, we reduced the fiscal deficit by cutting the fuel subsidy, by raising the fuel price by 30 to 44%, tightening the monetary policy, raise interest rate by 175 basis points, allowing exchange rate to depreciate. You could see in my chart that the foreign reserve, you know, after we took the expenditure switching policy, was basically increased because no intervention in the forex market. And prepared bilateral swap. This is very important because the stigma issue is still there. There was a need at the time to get a support of the second line of defense. But there is no way of Indonesia can go to the IMF because the stigma issue, it is politically unacceptable. If you recall 2008, during the global financial crisis, even Singapore, Korea, Brazil, and Mexico, none of them went to the fund. All of them went to the Fed to get the bilateral swaps at the time, because the stigma issue. So what we did at the time, we prepared the bilateral swap agreement only for the second line of defense, to China, Japan, Australia, ADB, and also the DDO, the deferred drawdown option from the World Bank. We basically could accumulate about $60 billion. So in total, our foreign reserve was about 160, $170 billion just to ease the market. We don't use the second line of defense. And then the other thing is we curb inflation by opening import. This is the favorite topic of Ibu Mary. Yeah, how to open import. We were able to do that, scrap the import of beef, especially from Australia at that time. The reason for two reasons. The first one is because bad times makes good policy, exactly what Pak Sadli argued at that time, because for the policymaker, it is important to ensure that inflation is relatively low. This is related to the approval rate of the president at that time. If the inflation went high, then the popularity of president will decline. So you open up import to ensure that the inflation is relatively low. The second one, you were able to open up import because you let the exchange rate to depreciate. So the industrialist, the producer, get what Max Condon called the exchange rate protection. So the combination of it, so if you want to liberalize the economy, let the exchange rate to depreciate, then somehow we'll give some cushion to the producer. Last but not least, bilateral currency. The last but not least, the macro prudential. There is no room for us to implement the capital control because it is stipulated in our law that our capital account is open capital account regime. So what we could do at the time was the reverse of the Tobin tax. If any of you are familiar with the Tobin tax, you tax with this short-term capital inflow, but what we did is if the foreign investor do not repatriate their profit, but instead reinvest their investment, we give them a tax break. So this is the reverse of the Tobin tax in order to go around with this capital control. Yeah, cash transfer for the poor, of course, because we cut the fuel subsidy and then the PNPM program, and We also provide the tax incentive if the industry prevent themselves to lay off the worker. But to be honest with you, this last policy, I don't think worked effectively at that time. This is the basically, I try to, you know, you can look at the list of policy in a very detail. This is based on the report made by the IMF. Yeah. And look at these fiscal and monetary policies in the fragile five countries. Let's compare Indonesia and India, very similar. What happened to Brazil? They raised the interest rate, yeah, but their current account deficit was already too large at the time. What about Turkey? Inconsistent on monetary policy. They were, you know, a little bit late in adjusting the interest rate. They raised the interest rate, but later on they decided to lower the interest rate. Even they haven't, you know, completed the process of tightening the economy at the time. So look at the similarities between Indonesia and India in responding to the taper tantrum from the monetary policy. Yeah, this is the interest rate. Yeah, Indonesia and India, the central bank policy. In terms of budget, also very similar, because both country, Indonesia and India, also cut the budget deficit. Now, the question is, so what makes difference between Indonesia and India? I think this story has to do with the terms of trade. Yeah, because as I mentioned in my earlier remarks that India is Indonesia without resources. Yeah, this is very important. So look at these terms of trade. The direction of these terms of trade is always on the contrary, on the reverse. So when the commodity price collapse, the terms of trade of India improve because they are net importer of energy and commodities. But in our case, because we are net exporter of energy, of commodities especially, yeah, when the commodity price collapse, we have an experience of this negative terms of trade. Is again back to the economic theory. If you get a problem of this negative terms of trade, it will affect your economic growth, it will affect your currency, it will affect your balance of payment. But the case of India is the other way around. Yeah. Now, after we did both Indonesia and India, we respond to the policy. I just quote the statement made by the IMF. This is Indonesia and India. Basically, the IMF said, since mid-2013, Indonesia has taken significant steps to strengthen policy and reserve buffers. And then the economy has been stabilized. India, over the past 4 months, a combination of improving external condition and domestic policy efforts have calmed markets. So you could see both India and Indonesia, in the relatively short period of time, managed to escape from the fragile five. And then that's what the media said, how India and Indonesia escaped the fragile five, because Turkey, South Africa, Brazil remain stay in the fragile five. Yeah, there was a title in the newspaper, and then there were three. The improvement was also recognized by the media and the investors. But the interesting, this is the latest report made by the IMF, I think it's about 2 weeks ago, on the Global Financial Stability Forum. The IMF shows that emerging market external balance have improved since the taper tantrum and reinforced positive financial market sentiment. If you look at India there and also Indonesia, both in terms of this external balance, it's improved a lot. So in response to the question from the Minister Sri Mulyani, if there are any risk of the taper tantrum to repeat again, my answer is yes, but probably the impact will be relatively less. Why? Because our external balances is much better now. In the last, I would say, in the last 4 years, yeah, because we try to lower the current account deficit. Somehow, this argue that maybe we need to concern also about the current account deficit if on the capital account is financed by the portfolio. Yeah, in the case of India, it also shows that, you know, even Brazil is improved now. So the situation probably not as bad as what we had back in 2013. The countries that we need to worry is about is Russia, specifically, yeah, about this situation. Now, the next question is why India performed better? Because both countries went to the fragile five at the same time, had a similarities, escaped from the fragile five basically about 7 months, 8 months after the situation. But why India perform better than Indonesia after taper tantrum? Yeah, this is very important, the lesson learned. The first one is, I think one of the explanation is the terms of trade. Because unlike Indonesia, India is net importer of commodity, so the positive effect of terms of trade, thanks to the declining energy and commodity prices, helps Indian economy a lot. Indonesia is on the reverse. The terms of trade, the negative effect, declining commodity prices really hit us. Then it takes me, triggered me into the next question. Whether the Indian economy will be sustainable or not in the future? I have a question this. Because I'm not really sure if one day the commodity price, hopefully this is not going to happen soon. But if let's say if something happened with the commodity price again, commodity super cycle again, what happened to the Indian economy? Maybe the situation will be, you know, on the reverse. The second one, on the case of India, optimism inspired by Modi's government reform, is doing business, infrastructure, open investment regime, was perceived very positively by the market. In the case of Indonesia, we had a similar optimism. But unfortunately, during the first months of President Jokowi's administration, yeah, there was a mixed signal about the openness, about the investment, the policy towards more open investment regime. The very obvious reform was definitely of removing the fuel subsidy at that time because the oil price was relatively low. But it's created a mixed signal. So India started, you know, faster than us because the investors perceived that a strong position towards the foreign investment in a sense become more open. And then the most important one, India did a very significant reform on the financial sector to open up the banking sector, for example. Yeah. And then case of India, significant improvement in the current account deficit thanks to declining commodity prices because their import dropped quite substantially. Whereas on the case of Indonesia, it's on the reverse. And relatively low current account deficit allow the Reserve Bank of India to lower the interest rate. Whereas in Indonesia, it's the other way around because Bank Indonesia need to maintain the somehow to link the monetary policy with the current account deficit. So it took longer for Bank Indonesia to lower the interest rate. Of course, this gave an impact on the monetary policy. Yeah. Last but not least, India maintained a very sound monetary and fiscal policy. In the case of Indonesia, unfortunately, in the last 2 years, we have the sound monetary policy, but there was a fiscal risk at the time. Fiscal risk loomed large from the tax target in 2015 and 2016, put our fiscal in the sort of like uncertainty at the time. So looking at this, yeah, I try to look at the correlation between Indonesia GDP growth and oil price. It's very clear. If you look at the GDP growth and oil price in the case of Indonesia, we have a positive correlation. But as for the India, it's a negative correlation. Yeah. So this is basically, you know, the story about this the two countries. So let me take some criticisms related to this this policy. The first criticism, this has been discussed a lot. Yeah. The current account deficit does not matter. No need to worry about it. I mentioned to you earlier about it. Yeah. You just need to use the exchange rate as the shock absorber. I recall Ibu Mary, there was a discussion and a limited breakfast at the IMF at the time because both Indonesia and India were asked to explain about their policy on handling the taper tantrum. And there was a question from Governor Carsten, the governor of Central Bank of Mexico at the time. He posed a very interesting question. He said that, why you need to worry about it? Why don't you just let the exchange rate to depreciate as the shock absorber? Unfortunately, for the case of Indonesia, I have to say, we had a trauma back on 1997. Every time the rupiah depreciate, then people start to think about this, the Asian financial crisis back. So there is a risk of the self-fulfilling prophecy and inertia. So somehow, there is a need for the government or the central bank intervention to ensure the smoothing process. So what the Indonesian government and the central bank will do is a bit of everything. We tighten the fiscal a little bit, we tighten the monetary policy a little bit, you let the exchange rate to depreciate a little bit as well. The mixed macroeconomic policy. Yeah, in open economy, Indonesia is a current account deficit. It's a principle. It's a very simply triggering the adjustment process, no need for policy. And last but not least, you know, one of the criticisms maybe is probably interesting to look at whether this policy was overkill or not. Yeah, because the cost of this policy, we deliberately slowing down the economy. As a result, our economic growth declined from 6.1% to become around 5.5% at the time. But the argument of the government, I'm not being defensive on it, there was a cushion of growth. If Indonesia can still grow by 5%, it's not bad compared to other countries. So you no need to worry if the economic growth drop from 5 to 6%. Of course, we can discuss about this issue later on. Last part, what are the lessons learned? And this is very important. The first one is capital inflow. The capital, every time there was a capital inflow, it reminds me with what Reinhardt and Rogoff said in their book. The policymaker, every time there is a capital inflow, they always say three words. This time is different. Yeah, they always said, you talk to the policymakers, when the rupiah gets strengthened, the capital inflow coming in, and we start to remind them, be careful about this capital inflow coming in, they always said, this time is different. Yeah, the situation is different. But the history shows that the capital inflow could lead to the real appreciation of the exchange rate. It is later on, we'll end up with the current account deficit. This will increase the vulnerability. The question is, sterilization is very expensive, especially for the case of Indonesia, in which the spread between Bank Indonesia rate and the Fed fund rate is about 500 basis points. So you could imagine the sterilization cost is very expensive. Yeah, and we could not implement the capital control because on the capital account side, it is stated in our law, is open capital account regime. So we need to explore macroprudential regulations. Cannot implement the Tobin tax here, but maybe if I may suggest in the future, there are several policies that we could implement. For example, if the private sector would like to borrow short-term money, ask them to put the deposit at least 1 year on the central bank, 20% at the central bank. This will prevent them to get the short-term borrowing. So they will borrow money for 2 or 3 years. So you don't need to worry about it. This is the way to sort of like to implement the Tobin tax in a different way. Or you increase the provision to transaction for the bond or also the stock market, if only for the short term. Yeah. The second one is high current account deficit makes economy become vulnerable if it's financed by the portfolio. Especially, this is our case now, if on the bond market, the bondholders, 38% is owned by the foreigners. Yeah, you could imagine if there is shock in the United States, then there is a risk of the capital inflow coming in, flowing out from the bond market. So if there is, I better be careful with my words here, because maybe some journalists here. If there is a risk of capital outflow, I would say it may come from the bond market. But at this stage, I don't see this to happen. So I have to make a qualification of this statement. Otherwise, we'll appear in the newspaper that the bond market will collapse. So we better be careful. So the lesson learned is, in the future, it is important to do the financial deepening, especially on the bond market. Yeah, pension fund, the insurance. On the monetary policy, in the case of Bank Indonesia, I think, because this lesson learned, to me, my criticisms to Bank Indonesia probably should adjust the interest rate earlier, probably in 2010. Yeah, when the capital current accounts began to experience a deficit. And maybe the government should adjust the fuel price much earlier than 2030. If the government raised the fuel price probably in 2010 or 2011, I believe that we were in the better shape to anticipate the taper tantrum in 2030. Yeah? And a dependency on external financing, I mentioned about it. To overcome the taper tantrum, consistency on stability over growth is very important. And this is very, I think this is the lesson learned that's also important. It is very important to ensure the coherence, the same position between government and the central bank. Because if the government continue to ask the central bank to lower the interest rate, yeah, or to intervene the central bank somehow to defend the exchange rate, then there will be inconsistency on policy. At that time, the good thing is the government was entirely support the central bank to let the exchange rate to depreciate and to raise the interest rate at that time. So this cooperation is a very important one. Yeah, exchange rate is important as shock absorber, but need clear and better information from both and central bank. Moving forward, the situation with the negative interest rate in Japan and Europe and the continued gradual normalization will allow capital inflow coming in into Indonesia, but don't forget, you know, the party will over. I don't know when, so we need to be careful to anticipate this. But the good thing is our current account deficit now is less than 2%. Yeah, the external balance is in a better shape. Our fiscal is in a better shape. So I think I'm more optimistic with the current situation. But the lesson learned from the 2013 taper tantrum, it's probably a valuable thing to learn both from India and Indonesia experience. I don't want to talk about the technical things. Yeah, but if you are interested to look at the relationship between the, let me just give some example of this result. This is the, you know, the result, the relationship between the impulse driven function between the budget surplus and the capital current account is positive. So if you increase the or reduce the budget deficit, that will improve the current account. If you look at the exchange rate, you see a sort of like evidence of the J curve, even for the interest rate. Yeah. So initially, the current account deficit will deteriorate, then later on will improve. So it shows that back again, that this expenditure switching and expenditure reducing policy actually work in reality. I stop it here. Thank you very much.